Okay. In the last class, we have discussed about the predator, predator, and that's the importance of the predation in the nature. Okay, and today we'll go with another interaction, that is the competition. Okay, when you observe here, when the Darwin, that means okay, in the evolution, the Darwin spoke of the struggle for existence. That means every organism will struggle, okay, for existence and the survival of the fittest in nature. That means those every organism will try to adapt to the changing in the environmental conditions, and those organisms which will adapt to the changing environmental conditions only will survive. That's what the struggle for existence and the survival of the fittest in nature, okay, that is. And he was convinced that interspecific competition is a potent force in organic evolution. Okay, that means, okay, when you observe here, the survival of any organism in the nature is because of a certain interspecific competition. That means those organisms which will win, okay, this competition among different species, those species will survive and they flourish well. That is what this concept is explaining. So that is, it is generally believed that competition occurs when closely related species compete for the same resources that are limiting, but this is not entirely true. Okay, generally we say that, okay, competition develops between, okay, the related species. That means, okay, the species which are very close, okay, and they'll compete for the same resources. When they are competing for the same resources, and that resources are also in a limited condition, okay, that is not entirely true. That is not correct, he is saying. Firstly, totally unrelated species could also compete for the same resource. Okay, not only the related species, but also unrelated species also can compete for the same resource. For instance, in some shallow South American lakes, shallow South American lakes, visiting flamingos and resident fishes compete for their common food. That is the zooplankton in the lake. Okay, the flamingos, okay, and the fishes, both are competing for the zooplanktons. Okay, flamingos belongs to birds, whereas the fishes are a different group. Okay, they are not related anywhere, but still they are competing for the same food material. Secondly, resources need not be limiting for competition to occur. That means here the resources might not be limiting. Even the unlimited resources present also, the competition may occur. Okay? Competition may occur. That is, in interference competition, the feeding efficiency of one species might be reduced due to the interfering and inhibitory presence of the other species, even if resources are abundant. Okay, that means if one species is efficient in getting the food material, and other species is not efficient in getting the food material, even the resource is unlimited. That means even the food availability is unlimited, but here may happen. Okay, something may happen. Okay, that means here the competition may occur between the inefficient organism and the efficient organism. Therefore, competition is best defined as a process in which the fitness of one species measured in terms of its R, the intrinsic rate of increase, is significantly lower in the presence of another species. So here, because of competition, what happens means, okay, the intrinsic growth of one species will be more when compared to the other species. Okay, that is, so it is relatively easy to demonstrate in the laboratory experiments. Okay, as Gauss and other experimental ecologists did, when resources are limited, the competitively superior species which will eventually eliminate the other species. But the evidence for such competitive exclusion occurring in nature is not always conclusive. That means it is not always correct. Okay, that means when resources are limited and there are two species are competing for the same food material, then what happens means, okay, the superior species, that means the species which is efficient in obtaining the food material, that species only will be flourished and the other species will be eliminated. Okay, this is called Gauss exclusive principle. Okay, but this is not always correct. Okay, strong and persuasive circumstantial evidence does exist, however, in some cases. But some examples are there in which the superior species are able to survive and the other species are eliminated. For example, we can see here, Abingdon tortoise in Galapagos Islands, extinct within a decade after goats were introduced on the island, apparently due to the greater browsing efficiency of the goat. Okay? Greater efficiency of the goat. Okay? That means in Galapagos Islands, there are no goats. But the human has introduced this goat into the Galapagos Island. Goat into the Galapagos Island. When they introduce the goat into the Galapagos Island, a goat is a herbivore. And this Abingdon tortoise is also a herbivore. It will also feed on the plants. But the goat, which is a more efficient feeder, okay, most efficient feeder, okay, what happened means it resulted in the decrease in the availability of food for the Abingdon tortoise. As a result, the Abingdon tortoise has been undergone extinction because the goat is the efficient feeder. And next, another evidence for the occurrence of competition in nature comes from what is called a competitive release, that is a species whose distribution is restricted to a small geographical area. Because of the presence of a competitively superior species is found to expand its distributional range dramatically when the competing species is experimentally removed. Okay, that is called a competitive release. That means here two species are competing for the same type of material in a small geographical area. Then what we are doing means, okay, we are expanding the area, distributional range. As a result, what happened? The two species which are living together in one area, now because of the area is increased, now these species have moved to other area. Okay, that means here the competing species is removed. As a result, the competition is released so that both the species can survive. Okay, a scientist called Connell's elegant field experiment showed that on the rocky sea coast of Scotland, the larger and competitively superior barnacle, Balanus, dominates the intertidal area and excludes the smaller barnacle, Cathamallus, from the zone. Okay? So in the coast, in the rocky sea coast of Scotland, what happened? The superior barnacle, that is Balanus, okay, it is dominating. It is the larger one, and it is dominating in the intertidal area. So when it is living, okay, it removed the barnacle catamalus from that zone. That means the competition is released. Okay, in general, herbivores and plants appear to be more adversely affected by competition than carnivores. Okay, because of competition, what happens? Okay, the plants and the herbivores are mostly affecting, not the carnivores, because carnivores are having a different types of food material for their feeding. Okay, that is to explain this competition. Okay, the scientist Gauss has given a principle called Gauss competitive exclusion principle. States that two closely related species competing for the same resource cannot coexist indefinitely, and the competitively inferior one will be eliminated eventually. That means if there are two different species are competing for the same resource of food material, then what happens? The superior only will survive, and the inferior one will be automatically get eliminated from that environment. That is called a competitive exclusion principle. Okay, this may be true if resources are limiting, but not otherwise. That means if the resources are limited, then this competitive exclusion principle exists. But if the resources are unlimited, okay, then this competition is nowhere. And the more recent studies do not support such gross generalizations about competition. Okay, that means the recent studies are not supporting this competitive exclusive principle. Why? Because different organisms are using different methods to release the competition. Okay, that is why. Because while they do not rule out the occurrence of interspecific competition in nature, they point out that species facing competition might evolve a mechanism that promote a coexistence rather than exclusion. So here what happened means, if the two different, okay, if different species are competing for the same type of material, okay, here instead of undergoing exclusion, okay, they are developing certain mechanisms, or they evolve certain mechanisms so that both can live together instead of removing one organism. So one such mechanism is resource partitioning. That means here, they obtain the food material at a different time period. That is called resource partitioning. If two species competing for the same resource, they could avoid a competition by choosing, for instance, different times for feeding or a different foraging pattern. Okay, that means they will obtain the food material at different time period. Okay, some will obtain the food during daytime, and some will obtain food material during nighttime. So by which they can reduce the competition so that both can coexist. They can live together. That is what the organisms have evolved. Okay, another scientist called MacArthur showed that the five closely related species of warblers living on the same tree were able to avoid competition and coexist due to behavioral difference in their foraging activity. That means they feed on the food material at a different periods of time. So because of that foraging periods, okay, behavioral in the foraging activities are obtaining the food material. Foraging means they are obtaining the food. Okay, because of that difference in the time periods, even though if they are living on the same tree, they are able to coexist. That means they can live together without developing any competition. That's why, okay, in most cases, okay, if they are feeding at the same time period, okay, generally they undergo one species will be removed, but if they have developed some mechanism to avoid this competition, then even different species can live in one habitat by avoiding competition. So most of the organisms will avoid competition by behavioral needs. Understood? Anybody is having any doubt here?
No, sir.
Okay. And next one is parasitism. Another, okay, interspecific interaction is parasitism. Okay, in parasitism, what happens? Okay, it is an interaction between two different species in which one species is benefited and the other species is detrimental. That is lost their life. Okay, that is parasitism. That is plus and minus. One species is benefited, okay, beneficial, and the other species is detrimental. Okay, that is parasitism. Considering that the parasitic mode of life ensures free lodging and meals, it is not surprising that parasitism has evolved in so many taxonomic groups, from plants to higher vertebrates. Okay, that means why this parasitism is getting, okay, is a happening means because the organism is getting free lodging and meals. Okay, they are getting free food material and free space. Okay, so that's why. And next, okay, we observe that this parasitism in different groups of plants and animals. Okay, starting from plants to vertebrates, even including human. Okay, that is. And next, many parasites have evolved to be host specific. That means the parasite which is causing, which is able to live in one host is unable to live in another host. That means it was developed in such a pattern. So many parasites have evolved to be host specific. That means they can parasitize only a single species of host in such a way that both the host and the parasite tend to co-evolve. That means here what happens when the host changes if the host undergoes any changes, according to that, the parasite also undergoes certain changes so that it can live better in that host. So here the co-evolution is taking place. That's why the hosts, the parasites are host specific. The parasites are host specific. Okay. So that is, if the host evolves special mechanisms for rejecting or resisting the parasite has to evolve mechanisms to counteract and neutralize them in order to be successful with the same host species. That means if the host has evolved certain mechanisms to prevent the infection from the parasite, according to that, the parasite also undergoes certain change for better living in that host. That's why the co-evolution is taking place between the host and the parasite. So in accordance with their lifestyles, parasites evolved special adaptations such as loss of unnecessary sense organ. So as the parasites are living inside the body of another organism, they doesn't want to sense the change because all the conditions are favorable. Already conditions are favorable, so it is able to survive well inside the host organism. So there is no need of sense organs which will sense the changes in the environment. So that unnecessary sense organs are lost. And next, some organisms have developed some adhesive organ. Presence of adhesive organ, that means which helps an attachment with the host, or suckers to cling onto the host. For example, if you observe the Tinea solium, which is the endoparasite of intestine, it is having suckers to hold to the intestine of the intestine of the host, okay, intestine, okay, the parasite will helps in attachment with the intestine of the host. Okay, such mechanisms we can see here. Okay, and the loss of digestive system, because already they obtain the digested food, completely digested food, and that can be directly absorbed and can be utilized. So there is no need of digestion of food. So what they will do means, okay, they slowly reduce the digestive system. And okay, and they have developed a high reproductive capacity because they can produce a large number of progeny so that they can spread to different hosts. Okay, and to increase the chance of transferring to the another host also. So that's why the reproductive capacity was increased enormously. So whatever the organs that are not required, they are reduced, and whatever the organs that are required, those are well developed so that they can survive better in the host organism. And next, the life cycles of parasites are often complex, involving one or two intermediate hosts or vector to facilitate parasitization of its primary host. Okay, that means, okay, when you observe the life cycles of the parasites, the life cycles of the parasites are a little bit complex. Okay, involving one or two intermediate hosts. Okay, some parasites will have, okay, one intermediate host, and some will have two or more number of intermediate hosts. Or they will use some vectors like the mosquitoes or some other house flies like that, so that they can easily transfer to the host organism, the primary host. So that is, for example, we can observe here the human liver fluke, a trematode parasite, that is, it is a nematode parasite, depends on two intermediate hosts, a snail and a fish, to complete its life cycle so that, okay, it can increase its chance of entering into the primary host. Because some will eat snail, some will eat fish. So what, okay, whichever they eat, okay, they can transfer to the primary host. So that is the, and next, the malarial parasite needs a vector mosquito to spread to other host. That means the malarial parasite is transmitted from one person to another person through mosquito. So that is, so majority of the parasites harm the host. They may reduce the survival, growth, and reproduction of the host and reduce its population density. Okay, so that is, when you observe here, majority of the parasites harm the host, they reduce the survival. That means, so that's why we are saying the one species is benefited and one is detrimental. That's why we are saying the host is harmed. Here, who is detrimental means host. Who is getting benefited means parasite. Okay, that's why we are saying the parasites harm the host. They may reproduce the survival. Sorry, they reduce the survival, growth, and reproduction of the host, and reduce its population density. And reduces the population density. They might render the host more vulnerable to predation by making it physically weak. Okay, that is, okay, they might render the host more vulnerable to predation by making it physically weak. Okay, and next, when you observe here, okay, so that means here, which is getting harmed means the host organism. The host species is affected. Why? Because it reduces the survival, because the parasite will affect certain organs that are present in the body. So the survival or the lifespan of that organism is reduced by reducing the growth and the reproduction. As a result, the population density of that host species is reduced. And next, even what happened because of the, okay, infected with the parasite, what happens? The host organism becomes physically weak and is vulnerable to predation. That means they will be easily caught up by the predator. caught up by the predator. So that is that. Okay, do you believe that an ideal parasite should be able to thrive within the host without harming it? Then why didn't natural selection lead to the evolution of such totally harmless parasites? Okay, here what happened means it is also a phenomenon in the nature. If a population was okay, it will be okay. The average lifetime of a parasite will vary from one parasite to another parasite. How we can say with the it will be varying from one parasite to another parasite. From one organism, every organism will not have the same lifespan. No, different organisms are having different lifespan, and that one will vary. Like that, the parasites will also have different lifespan. So that's what. Do you believe that an ideal parasite should be able to thrive within the host without harming it? Okay, that is here. What happens means nature has developed this parasite to reduce the density of a one population. So the aim of the nature is to reduce a certain population density by using this organism. That's why this is not happened. Okay, then why didn't natural selection lead to the evolution of such totally harmless parasites? Why the nature has developed such ones means? Because the nature's aim is to reduce the, to maintain that population in the nature. So this is the mechanism by which it controls the growth of certain organisms' population. That's why they are developing, these parasites are developing. So that's why the nature is not making the host organism to develop against the parasite. And next, when you observe the parasites are differentiated into different types. Okay, here we can see the parasites that feed on the external surface of the host organism are called ectoparasites. The most familiar examples of this group are the lice on humans and ticks on dogs. Okay, we'll find small insects in the hair. No. Okay, those are called lice. And in the hair of animals, we call it as the ticks. Okay, that is, these are ectoparasites because they are living on the external surface of the organism and living as parasites. And next, many marine fishes are infested with the ectoparasitic copepods, which belongs to the phylum Arthropoda. And next, in case of plants also, we'll find certain parasites like cuscuta, a parasitic plant that is commonly found growing on hedge plants, has lost its chlorophyll and leaves in course of evolution. This cuscuta, which is a complete parasite, which lives on the hedge plant, that is the large plants, in course of evolution, it lost chlorophyll because it is obtaining nutrients from the host plant, and it also lost the leaves. Why? Because there is no need of preparation of food material. So it derives its nutrition from the host plant, which it parasitizes. Okay, there is that. And next, when you observe here, the female mosquito is not considered a parasite, although it needs our blood for reproduction. Can you explain why? Because here, the female mosquito is taking the food material for its physiological activity. Okay, as it is using for its physiological activity like reproduction. That's why the female mosquito is not considered as a parasite. Why? Because even though it is taking, it is obtaining the blood from the vertebrate host, but that blood is required for its physiological activities like reproduction. That's why the female mosquito is not considered as a parasite. Okay, there is. And next, when you observe, once you listen here, ma, on Monday, you will be having a 50-mark test, ma, in the evening between 6 to 8. In the evening between 6 to 8, we will have 2-hour test for 50 marks. Okay, tomorrow and the day after tomorrow, you are having a holiday, they said. So, you can prepare well. Okay, and the syllabus for this test is second chapter and the third chapter, sexual reproduction in flowering plants and the human reproduction. These two chapters you can go through. Already we have completed before. Okay, we have not written the chapter wise test on this topic, so we are going with this 50 marks test this time. With these two chapters, there is a chapter 2, that is sexual reproduction in flowering plants, and chapter 3, that is a human reproduction. These two chapters is the syllabus for the Monday test for 50 mark. It will be in the evening 6 to 8. So tomorrow and a day after tomorrow we can prepare, and Monday afternoon also you can prepare. Okay. And Monday evening you can write. Okay, it will be pattern. 1 mark, 1 mark, 2 mark, 3 mark, and 5 mark. Okay, 10, 1 mark. Okay, 10, 1 mark, and next 10, 1 mark, 2 mark, 3 mark, and 5 mark. 5 2-mark questions will come. Sorry, 2 5-mark questions will come, and next I think 4 10 10 20, and next remaining 30 marks. 30 marks means we can have like a 2 mark and 5, 2 mark and 3 mark questions will be there. So overall 50 marks will be there. So we'll get 1 mark, 2 mark, 3 mark, and 5 mark. Okay. Okay, there is. And the remaining part, that is the endoparasites, we'll discuss in the next class. So you can prepare that one and complete the record work. Monday I will check all your record works.